The English game is really about an extraordinary moment in, I was going to say British football, but really football, which was when the working class teams took over the game.
The English game is ultimately a story of two men from vastly different worlds, vastly different backgrounds, and how they influenced and revolutionised football as we know it today, and ultimately revolutionised society today.
For me, it's about the two central characters, one an old Etonian, Arthur Kinnaird, the other a Scotsman who comes down and plays for Darwin and the Lancastrian team called Fergus Souter, and two men from very different backgrounds and how they have to rise above the circumstances of their birth to see the future of the game. But it's also about the class war of the ruling elite trying to keep control of a part of England that they felt was theirs.
My team has unfairly been kicked out of the FA Cup final.
Monkey, you know these people. Is there any hope of them considering?
Really, it's showing football at the centre of what was going on within British Victorian society at the time, which was huge social changes, social upheaval.
What Julian brings to the script is what he does, great drama from the heart and from the people. And, you know, if someone said, oh, it was the English game, and you immediately go, oh, it's a foot, you wouldn't say it's a football show, because that's just a very small element of it.
What was exciting to me, the cast is fantastic. The actual depth of talent through the whole cast is extraordinary, I think. It's probably one of the most exciting casts I've ever worked with.
I'm considering some work on our ground. Tell me, how much did it cost to level your playing field?
The two principal players, if you like, the leaders of the two groups, are a chap called Arthur Kinnaird, later Lord Kinnaird, who was an old Etonian, very much a founder member of the Football Association, very signed up to the way the others were thinking at the beginning.
There's the highest compliment, Mr. Souter. Don't think for a second you're going to beat us.
I play Arthur Kinnaird. He is captain of the Old Etonians, arguably at the time the best footballer in the country, certainly the first proper football star. And when you read about him, everyone says the same thing, that he sort of couldn't sit still and cared deeply for other people, like had this incredible empathy about him, which was unusual for someone from that kind of background.
And we have in this story, Kinnaird coming to the realization that the life they're leading is completely different. He can hardly grasp it. He can hardly understand it. And on the other side, we have Fergus Souter, who was essentially the first professional football player. He started in Partick Thistle up in Scotland, and then he was paid to join Darwin, and then he was paid to change to Blackburn, and so on.
So I play the character of Fergus Souter. Souter was a real person, a historic person. He was a peerless footballer. His ability was exceptional, specifically with the ball, specifically with defending and heading the ball. He had leadership qualities in his character that stood out amongst the rest. He comes from a very bleak and broken family in terms of his father was an abuser and a drunk. There is no doubt in my mind that football is what it is today because of and thanks to Fergus Souter.
If you ban us from the final, it's not just the players you're hurting. It's all the people who stood on the sidelines cheering them on, come rain or shine.
He isn't sentimentalised. He was a professional player. And if you paid him enough, he would switch teams and go off to the other team, even if it was, as in the case of going to Blackburn, that they're bitter enemies.
Those are the two key characters, but then there are other fantastic characters. Martha, who's the woman that Souter is falling in love with, but is seemingly unavailable.
She is strong in a way that I don't think I have ever been tested as much as she has. She's kind of a woman ahead of her time, and yeah, I think I almost wish I was a bit more like her, in fact.
She represents a woman to Fergus that he's never seen before, a woman who's strong and independent and powerful.
The women in this are so kind of red-blooded and real and complicated and human and flawed.
Alma, Kinnaird's wife, who becomes involved in the whole world of the women's refuge.
For me, Alma has a heart of gold. She's kind and she's warm and she's loving and she cares. And a lot of this story for her is about loss, but it's also about finding purpose. It's really about people from different worlds meeting in the middle and seeing each other.
Football is the anchor, if you like, but it's a big, big canvas. That's part of what attracted me to it. It's a huge gallery of characters across all spectrums of society at the time.
Tomorrow will be the first working men's team to bring home the FA Cup, and we'll have these lads to thank for it.
The story is essentially all true in terms of what happened across that period. Fergus Souttar and Arthur Kinnaird are real people, and a lot of the characters in the show around them are real people, or based on perhaps an amalgamation of people or events. And Arthur Kinnaird and Fergus Souttar, we've really worked on to build those real characters. In fact, Kevin Guthrie, who plays Fergus Souttar, is almost a spitting image of Fergus Souttar, and certainly once he's in costume and makeup, when you look at the picture of him, it's almost identical.
You're a decent man. It's hard for me to praise an old Etonian, but I mean it.
It's really important in dramas like this for them to feel real and visceral and gritty. It's all about character, and it's all about the texture of those characters and the reality of them. And the same, Pam Down is our costume designer, and her costumes are beautiful. They're just the detail and the feel of them and the look of them.
So I think increasingly, more than ever, authenticity is really important to viewers. You know, it's a shame when you realise that the true story was perhaps more interesting than what you've just seen. So we worked really hard on that, and so many of those tiny details are absolutely true, down to the referees wearing, you know, top hats and long tailcoats. We've worked to be very authentic to the central truth of the story and what happened.
The fabrics generally are quite hard to find. The football kits were our biggest challenge, basically. We had to research the boots, we had to research fabrics, we had to research the strips, the colours that they wear as well. The authenticity is important, but it has to be practical. So we had to find a mill up north that could weave the fabrics that looked like wool with the right kind of gauges in order to get away with making it out of cotton. So that proved to be quite a struggle.
And because it's Julian Fellowes, we all know that he has a high standard when it comes to historical accuracy. We specifically had footballs made. We had about 20 of them made in the end. So we went through a few different versions. We'd make a sample, ship it out. We would look at it and say, oh, can we tweak this? Can we tweak that? He got some hand-tanned leather specially made for us because we wanted to have that natural look to it. So then I had lots of conversations with the football choreographer, who asked if we could have two different types of bounce made in the ball. So we had normal footballs made, which bounce like a normal football does. And then we had some made with a futsal ball bladder inside, which are indoor footballs. So they have, instead of just being air, they've got foam inside their bladder, so they bounce sort of half as much.
The FA Cup itself, we modelled that. We went back and dug out incredible archives from places just to get those tiny details beyond the story itself.
The FA Cup was probably the main prop make of the show. We had a cast of the real one made and cast it in fiberglass and then sprayed it with a paint effect that looked just like sterling silver.
Well, when we approached the show, we knew that we had these two worlds that come together and clash. There's the upper class world and there's the working class world. Now, that working class world, a lot of that exists around mills, the mill town that we have, Darwin, and you just don't find that anywhere except the north and northwest of England. And so we thought it would make a lot of sense to base ourselves out of Manchester in the northwest and film up there, and then try and find the upper class locations that often are meant to be in London, but you can find those in other places like Liverpool and Manchester and all around there in kind of country houses.
It was very important to make this whole thing feel very immediate and relevant to a modern audience, and hopefully brings that period to life in a very contemporary way. The fact that it's written by Julian Fellowes, obviously people know him from Downton Abbey, but also this is more like his film Gosford Park, which is a rather darker, still with humour, but a darker exploration of class and England.
He completely understands story that there is to tell, but he says it's such a good story and the facts are better than the fiction.
I don't play so I can eat off fine china with silver spoons. I do it for me. I do it for all the people like me, stood in the stands.
there are divides that are heightened in the script that are absolutely still going on today.
There's many elements of what makes this a brilliant drama, but for me, the North class divide is where it really ramps up, because it's about fighting for injustices.
It was the role the game was playing in society and how it was altering the culture of the mill towns and the coal towns and so on. This was, in a sense, the working class beginning to understand its power.
The cloth they wear may be finer, but you're a better man than most of them.
And eventually, of course, would lead to the working class really dominating the 20th century in the sense of being responsible, being the source of wealth and the source of so much. That was originally played out in football, and after the victory in football would come larger victories. It's a David and Goliath story, which I think always has an appeal. There is a kind of feeling of can-do in it. I think it is possible to achieve quite a lot if you try hard enough. And that is one of the messages of this story.